under his feet. It was all done on Calvary when they nailed him to a tree. It took away our transgression and all iniquity. Well, by his blood we've been cleansed and now we have liberty.
So let me tell you about Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus is, he's the rock of all ages.
much more.
Much more.
Hallelujah. Much more. Amen. Is he your much more this morning? Think about that. Say that. Is he my much more?
Is he much more?
Is he my much more?
Yes.
Yes.
Is he my much more?
Yes.
Glory.
He's much more than what your mind could even think, hope, or ask of.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Technical difficulty, because when we take down equipment and try to put it back together, it's not always an easy thing to get it all right. Oh, and because of that pause, after that pause, we're going to do something that's really a blessing. We're going to pick up the offering.
Come on. Amen.
Pastor said we're going to pick up the offering, so we're going to ask Sister Mary to come on up here right now. She's going to bless us with a song. And I want us to just reach into our pocketbooks. I guess that's where you carry it. And I got a little reverb going on. That's what I'm hearing in it. In my head, is that from our PA? Okay, Robert, there's reverb. Can you get that out of there? The boys are saying you can.
I think it's in there.
It's coming out of your mains.
Yeah, it's up here.
It's in your mains. There we go.
Amen.
Yay. Everybody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Now the good news is we're going to praise him with our giving.
Amen.
How many of you know that when we give it, and we know this, but do we know this? It's worship.
Amen.
It's worship.
It is. Amen.
And we're the beneficiaries of that great worship unto God. Now, can you imagine that? You're giving to him in worship. And it comes back as a blessing in more than just ways of accounts of money. On the account of your life being blessed with the goodness of God, with the knowledge of God, with the understanding, but above all, with the revelation of God. Amen?
Amen.
There's not a greater giving than you and I can receive, but to understand and have revelation upon the issues of life today. Amen? So, Lord, we just thank you for this offering. I'm going to ask that our precious Brother Larry would come up, and Sister Mary, thank you. She's going to bless us with a song here this morning. But praise the Lord. I'm sorry, guys. It was a late evening. And woo, you just, if any of you have ever stepped out to do any kind of outreach, it's more than sometimes one can imagine. But I can only tell you this. It's for the glory of God. And when it's all said and done, you know, it's really footwork. It's the field work that God's called us to.
Hallelujah.
And if we get so complacent, now I could preach in this zone. If we get so complacent to sit in pews and just to keep hearing the word and just hearing the word and not reaching out with what you're hearing, shame on us. And unfortunately, I believe that's the state of the church. I'm not speaking that over him. I'm saying what can be seen. We've heard the gospel preached for many of us, 40, 50, maybe longer, and then those who have heard least. But it still seems like there is a lowness. And you know what? That's the adversary's job. To get you complacent, to get you lethargic, to get you to not open your mouth. Do you know how even asking people, and praise God for Megan yesterday, who was excited to stand up and testify for what the Lord has done for her household. Do you know how hard that is to say, even at times here? Does anybody have a praise report? Anybody want to give glory to God?
Amen.
And yet it's like a stifle comes over you. I can't open my mouth. No, you can tell. And you should tell. You want me to tell you why you should tell? Because you're telling on the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the glory, the soon coming King who will rule and reign. Amen? So we should tell. Amen. So Lord, we just bless you. We thank you for this offering, Father. Lord, I thank you for what you're doing in the midst of throughout this United States of America. Lord, I know we're seeing many things unfolding, God, as your word said it would be. But Lord, it's not for us to be faint-hearted, but it's for us to look up and, as Brother Larry said, Maranatha, even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly. But thank you for us being the beacon, that shining light, Lord, that will continue to herald the greatness, the goodness of God. Bless these monies that they may go forward to keep our pastor, to keep his household, and Lord, to further this gospel with vision. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. As I got up this morning, the Holy Spirit placed this song on my heart. There's nothing more powerful than the blood of Jesus Christ. If it was one drop, that's all we'd have to speak. I pray that the Holy Spirit will minister to you through these words as he did me this morning. You know, as I got up, I said, you know, Lord, it was all day, but I'm going to do it again because I was fighting. I said, I'm just going to sit today, Lord. I'm going to take a break. The flesh, you know, what's the devil? It was that flesh fight. And I was like, but I pray that this song will minister to you because, you know, when I go through something, I remember this one song you gave me. Bear with me. It's been a long time since I've sang it. But whatever comes out, I know that the Holy Spirit, because of obedience, he's going to minister to your heart.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Standing in the corner when I heard how do you plead, the accuser of the brethren was staring at me. He said, we've got your number, there is no escape, for here are your transgressions, your failures and mistakes. He pointed to the corner where the scales of justice stood. I saw so many failures there. There was nothing good. And in that very moment, when it seemed all hope was lost, I said, I plead the blood of Jesus and his death upon the cross. One drop of in silence as others were brought in. I saw them start to tremble when they turned and faced their sin. They offered no excuses, they offered no alibi. The truth was overwhelming and it could not be denied. Their righteousness like filthy rags, nothing they could say. They bowed their heads in silence as they were led away. For the true believer, each time it was the same. His glory shone around them as they called upon his name. One drop, it failed to the scale. It covered my transgressions. drop of blood.
Hallelujah. We're going to get this. Y'all looking so pretty this morning.
You ready?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're ready this morning. Praise the Lord. Love, come down. Ooh, yeah, 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 down. for loving us, Lord, unconditionally. Thank you, Jesus.
Have you ever felt that you like gone to the end of the line, hanging on a dangling string, and this it just seems so big that there's no way that you're going to overcome it? But you know, sometimes that happens to us for a reason. You know, sometimes he puts a wall there to see if you're just going to go through it, to see how strong your faith is. Sometimes, you know, it takes a big, big thing to get you to get back on track. I know he's done it to me. And I was just singing this song and it ministered to me so much, so I'm going to sing it for you. Faced a mountain I never faced before. That's why I'm calling on the Lord. I know it's been a while, but Lord, hear my prayer. I need you like I never had before. Oh, never before.
Sometimes it takes a mountain.
Oh, sometimes
a troubled sea.
Oh, troubled sea.
Lord, get a hold of me. Your love is so much stronger than whatever troubles me.
Oh, whatever troubles me.
Sometimes and believe.
Forgive me, Jesus. I thought I could control. That's funny, huh? Whatever life would throw my way, this I will admit has brought me to my knees. I need you, Lord. I'm not ashamed to say.
Sometimes it takes a mountain.
Well, sometimes it takes a mountain.
Sometimes a trouble. Lord, to trust you and believe. Sometimes it takes a mountain. Sometimes a troubled sea.
Sometimes a troubled sea.
church. We must trust him and believe.
Let's let the church sing it, y'all.
Sometimes it takes a mountain.
Sing it to Jesus, church.
Hallelujah.
Sometimes a troubled sea. Sometimes it takes a desert.
Amen.
Or to get a hold of me.
Oh, that's beautiful. Sing it to Jesus, church.
Your love is so much stronger. Lord, we have to trust you and believe. Trust him and believe.
falls from my eyes.
This morning, yesterday, under that pavilion, amen, out where strangers that we have not ever even met were walking by and seeing these ladies just worshiping the Lord, hallelujah, saturating the atmosphere with the mighty presence of Almighty God, amen. I'm excited.
Hallelujah.
I come this morning with a spirit of expectation.
Amen.
Amen. If you don't expect God to do something, guess what? He ain't going to do it.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We'll just give a moment for people to get occupied, settled. Amen. Our little ones going to their class. If you have your Bibles this morning while they're being dismissed, turn to St. John chapter 1, verse 32. Hallelujah. St. John, chapter 1, verse 32. I have been inspired this week. My spirit is just, I'm about to pop. You ever ate a good meal and you just rub your old belly and say, I'm about to pop. Amen. That's the way I feel in the spirit. This morning, I'm going to minister to you something that I've been studying this week, and when I stumbled into this, it began to just like an artesian well began to flow in my spirit, and I said, "Wow!" I said, "The church needs to hear this," and I just want to share something with you this morning. I won't keep you long. Pray for us today. We've got a go to Amen. I guess I can make a public declaration. Megan's getting married today, for you that know Megan. Just pray for her. Praise God. Hallelujah. And so we want her best wishes, obviously, but That's another story with our granddaughter. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. That's why I got all these gray hairs. St. John chapter 1 verse 32. When you're there, say amen.
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 And the scripture says, and John bear record. In other words, he saw this. He experienced this. He witnessed this. This was not a campfire story. This was not a spiritual metaphor. This was an actual event that occurred, and it took place, and he witnessed it. And John bare record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. Talking about Jesus. And I knew him not, but when he sent me, he baptized with water. The same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining.
Hallelujah.
The same is he which baptized with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. I want to minister to you something this morning that I just spoke this to me this week through some devotion and reading and studying that I've done. I want to minister to you this morning a few minutes about pigeon religion.
Oh.
We need to bring back the dove. We've settled for pigeon religion in place of the dove.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
As I began to study this, my mind was blown. Because you know what? Anatomically, a dove and a pigeon looks like they're the same. But temperately, they're different in a lot of ways. And so from a distance, a lot of times what you say, oh, honey, look, there's a nice dove up there on that. No, really what it is, a pigeon. But this message today is twofold, and I'm not going to exhaust it today. I already feel in my spirit to preach this again next week because there's some people that's not here today that needs to hear this. But we're settling for pigeon religion rather than seeking the dove.
Hallelujah.
And the dove does for us a lot more than what the pigeon does. But I want you to take a journey with me this morning because it's time for us to seek the face of God until the dove returns to our church.
Amen.
And I'm talking about the Holy Ghost.
That's right. Come on now.
Amen.
I'm talking about true manifestations of God. Yeah. Not goosebumps and jigger jaggers. I'm talking about the manifestation of God in which I was talking to a lady. Let me just throw this in, not getting on a rabbit trail, but it goes in with what I have this morning. Because you see, when pigeons are in the church, there's no fear of God.
That's right. Amen.
That's why today people are playing games with God. It's because they don't fear God. They've never been in a service that was so authentic of the moving of the Holy Spirit that they saw God in action. And so what we've been calling a movement of the Holy Ghost is just a bunch of pigeons flying around. Man-made. We get so caught up in the flesh. Amen. Let me tell you something. There's a lot different flowing in the spirit than flowing in the flesh. But if you don't know the difference, it looks the same.
Right.
If you don't know the difference between a pigeon and a dove, they look the same. But you've got to get up close and personal. You've got to get close and personal. Amen. With a dove to be able to understand and learn the temperament of the Holy Spirit.
That's right. Amen.
And today we're passing off just the moves of the flesh and entertainment. Mm-hmm. as a move of God.
Come on, right.
And so as I began to study this out and began to read this, I began to marvel at God. Because the scripture says it's the glory of God to conceal a thing, but honor of kings to search out a matter. Amen. And there are things that are hidden because we're too lazy to seek it out. But when you begin to unearth what God has hidden in the pages of His scripture, and you begin to study it, you go, wow, that's awesome, that's deep. But John said, I bear record. He wrote it. It was recorded that I saw. Can I tell you what we're replacing by what we're seeing today is stories that's been handed down from one church to another church, from one generation to another generation, and we've heard all the stories, but we've never seen the move of God. And we've counted that as the move of God. Think about it. I've been 30 years better in ministry. And I've been in a lot of services. Brother Gary, that got me so caught up in the rapture of my flesh.
Come on.
And man, I said, man, the glory of God was in that house tonight. Man, we experienced the Shekinah glory. No, we didn't. We experienced pigeon religion. See, there are things that we're calling a move of God right now in the Pentecostal church, in the charismatic movement, that it's a move of God. No, it's just man caught up in flesh.
Come on, preach that, brother.
Because he doesn't live the consecrated life so the dove can dwell inside of him.
Hallelujah.
Most of our services, and I'm bragging about victory because we're on a cutting edge of a fork in the road. And I believe that in all my heart. And let me tell you something. I'll give you a prophetic warning right now. When God starts busting loose, we're going to really see who loves God and how pigeonholed you really are.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I've heard it. God began to move in a lot of churches and a lot of the set traditional ways began to fight against the move of God. And the Holy Spirit's grieved and He leaves. And he leaves man alone to entertain himself. But let's look this morning at the characteristics of a dove. And listen to this. Here's my definition of pigeon religion. It is the encroachment of any teaching, ministry, or practice that you thought was a dove. The authentic Holy Spirit, but turns out it was to be a pigeon, the counterfeit. In a word, the flesh. The flesh is a very powerful thing. But if we're not walking in the Word of God, you will never be able to discern what is flesh and what is spirit.
Amen.
You see, when you begin to spend time alone with God in prayer and you get into His Word, there's something, you may not see it physically, but internally there's a transformation that begins to take place. All of a sudden, and it's no red lights, it's no flashing lights, there's no sonic booms, there's no smoke, there's no thunder. You just start saying, you know, I don't want to watch that no more. Your conversations change.
That's right. Amen.
You're no longer gossiping anymore. Matter of fact, you shun it. All of a sudden, you find yourself reading the Word of God. And you're not just reading a book. You're asking in your own heart, Lord, begin to give me revelation of what I'm reading so that I may know You. There's something that begins to happen in your heart that you begin to hone in on God. You want to listen to gospel music, not country music. You want to listen to the Word of God being ministered. You want to talk about God. Used to you would talk about football. Used to you'd talk about Sadie Sue. Used to you'd talk about the neighbor next door. But now you want to talk about God.
Oh, that's right.
And let me tell you something, church. When you begin to transition from that pigeon religion and the dove begin to take over in your tabernacle.
That's right.
Them other pigeons that's around you, they gonna fly away.
Yeah, that's right.
Let's look at something this morning. The difference between a pigeon and a dove, especially a turtle dove. Pigeons fight with each other. You ever been in them church fights? Huh? Well, bless God, we don't like that blue carpet. Man, that music's too loud. Bless God, we got to bring back the hymnals. Hey, that church splits. There's nothing wrong with that, no misunderstanding. But when it's a pigeon mentality, it becomes critical, it becomes fault-finding, it becomes damning rather than giving life, it's speaking death. Because the Bible does say there's life and death in the power of the tongue.
That's right.
In church it works.
Yeah, that's right.
Try it sometime. Start speaking life into your situation rather than death. Start speaking. I'm not talking about name it and claim it. I'm talking about speak the Word of God. That's why He wrote it. I can't help what the Word and faith preachers did with it, run off and made a fool of themselves, but I'm not going to let them deny me my right to speak life.
Yes, that's right.
Hallelujah.
Because they've distorted the Word of God.
Amen.
You have not because you ask not.
Mm-hmm.
When are you going to get bold in your asking?
That's right.
We come to God, oh Lord. Lord, if it be your will. Lord, I need $100 this week. Lord, if it be your will, you'll provide. Come on, church. The Bible says, come boldly before the throne of the Lord. I don't know about you, but I've gotten out of this fear mentality and asking my Father for help. That pigeon religion, it warped my mind. But now I know I have rights and I have privileges. I have authority. And I can walk in that. Why? Because the doves return to my home.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to this. Pigeons fight with each other. Doves never fight. Pigeons are belligerent. Doves are peaceful. Pigeons are noisy. You ever been around a bunch of pigeons? I think one flew over my car this morning because he knew I was going to preach this message. And he anointed my car.
He did mine too.
Did he do? It must have been the same one. I seen a dove. God's my witness. I was pulling in the driveway. Coming back to the house this morning, there was a dove in my driveway.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. And I said, Lord, that's confirmation
that
about the
message.
Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, don't let the messenger mess up the message.
Awesome.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen to this. Pigeons are not bothered by noise. Think about it, in the church. I'm talking about spiritually in the church. People in church want to be noisy. See, because the more clatter we have, the less time we're sensing the voice of God. Noise drowns out the whisper of God. That's why doves like quietness. Because when you're quiet, let me tell you something, church. Pan over him, Brother Brian. Now, Brother Brian's, I thank God for this, because this is a blessing. We're now being able to record our services and putting them on YouTube. So now I have to be careful what I say.
No editing.
And so, but I thank God for these. I really do. I thank God for cell phones, iPads. They're great. They're a great instrument. But sometimes we get so caught up with these things.
Say that. Say it loud.
That we don't take time to study the Word of God. I have fought the devil over this. I would be set studying. And all of a sudden, I got to check my email. I got to see if anybody tried to call me. I got to go on Facebook. Let's see what's everything on Facebook.
You're preaching there.
Rather than staking, being focused. Yeah.
On the word.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's
right. Is that true?
Yes, sir.
Y'all don't raise your hands if you're guilty. Yeah. Got them nubs up close. But the Lord wants us to shut ourselves away with Him. And to be sensitive to where we can hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying.
Come on.
Amen.
The reason we operate in pigeon religion and do things in the flesh a lot of times is that we're not listening to what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. And if I'm not hearing what the Spirit of the Lord is saying, guess what? I get in the flesh. I've been guilty of this. I have been in the flesh where I'd get so busy during the week that it would come time to get ready for a message rather than praying and taking the time being alone with the Lord to hear what the dove's got to say. I'll find me something else. Oh, that was preached before. I can go back and preach. It worked one time. Let me see, Brother Hugh, if it'll work again.
Come on.
Hello?
Yeah, that's right.
Double dipping.
Pigeons love attention.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Man, that old flesh man just loves that recognition.
Ow!
Come on now. Pigeons don't like that. I mean, doves don't like that. Did you know pigeons are greedy?
Yeah.
I'm fixing to preach now.
Come on. That's it.
I thought, how was I going to talk about that, Lord? Man, yeah, hey, thank you, Jesus. You know, you can be poor and be greedy.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah.
Just as a wealthy person is greedy.
Amen.
We're materialistically bound in this world that we're living in. And I'm not going to get on this because it's not the time or the place, but then again, it may very well be the time or the place. We can run out at the drop of a hat. If you get that, my wife, bless her heart, I love her to death, but I wish Stage would quit sending me stuff in the mail.
Preach that again, brother, one more time.
Oh, look! Oh! 40% off at Stages. I gotta go get me a new blouse. And I said, honey, there's more blouses in that closet than you'll wear, but I can't wear them now.
See?
I can relate.
Preach that, brother.
But we can find ways to go to JCPenney's and Stages and buy stuff. We'll put it on our debit card. Well, I'll pay it next month. But when it comes to giving in the church, get on away from there, preacher.
Yeah.
Don't talk about money in church now. That's what you preachers always talk about. No, it ain't. How many sermons have y'all heard me preaching in almost 2 years we've been here on money?
Not a one.
Not a one. Guess what? Because that piece of paper, I'm okay. That piece of paper they give me every morning when they count the money. We got $419 this morning. We need $700. You do the math. But I guess what? I'm going to preach. Some of y'all going out and eating ain't going to miss a meal. Some of y'all talking about Stage. Oh, you know what? I think I'll stop by there after church. Get on, Brother Bassemeyer. This is going to be on YouTube. And I want you people watching on YouTube today hear this. You better start giving.
Whoa!
And you can send it to 446 North Sterling. Keep your tithes, send your offerings to 446 North Sterling Victory Tabernacle.
Lafayette, Louisiana,
705-01. Get this. Pigeons get dependent on man for food. Hello, let me stop. I'm preaching now. I thank God that I have an opportunity to preach the gospel. But God have mercy on you if you only wait till you get to church on Sunday morning to get fed.
Amen.
And you have no more appetite for the word of God and a spiritual move of God in your life than you do that you only do it once a week.
Amen.
That's a pigeon. Because then you start depending on man to feed you rather than seeking God. Let me tell you something. I'm not going to lie to you. Prayer is hard work.
Amen.
Prayer is diligent, soul-searching, giving of yourself to the point where it many people don't want to pray. And so we've settled into this pigeon religion. Well, rather than me pray, I'll get Brother Bassemer just to tell me what I need to hear. Can I preach this morning?
Yes,
or we'll tune in to Brother Jimmy. Let him feed me. Rather than picking up the word of God for ourselves.
Woo!
Amen.
And study it. Now, I'm not against that. Y'all know my heart. But let me tell you something. If we get so dependent on what somebody else is saying rather than on what God is saying to us.
Yeah.
That's it.
There's a preacher on TV right now. He's raking in millions.
Yeah.
One of the hottest preachers swinging out there. But he said you don't have to repent of your sins.
Oh my goodness.
Not only did he say it on national television, he put it in one of his books. That's pigeon religion. But let me tell you something. Popularity in the man will distort your view of God.
Amen.
Listen to me. Popularity in the man, just because they're popular, just because they pastor big churches, just because they may go overseas, doesn't mean they're preaching the Word of God. That's why we've got to study the Word of God and hear what the Spirit is saying to compare it with the Word that they're preaching. So you'll know the difference.
Amen.
But pigeons only eat, doves only eat seed and fruit. Something that's good for you. Jesus is fruitful.
Yes, he is.
He's fruitful.
That's right.
Amen. Listen to this. This is kind of crude, but it's necessary. That the droppings of a pigeon will ruin what it abodes on. Look at a lot of statues that were once bronze, that once shined. Now they're distorted with bird droppings. Pigeon religion, man-made religion, can I say this?
Say it.
It's a bunch of crap.
That's right.
Literally.
Literally. Paul called it dumb. Why? Because it hurts you. When pigeon religion is dropped in your spirit, it begins to tarnish you and distort you. You may not recognize it at first. Amen. But let me tell you something. What happened to me? Personal experience. Amen. I get in the church. I get filled with the Holy Ghost. I get baptized. Amen. I buy me a King James Bible. Man, I'm hot for God. I'm flowing. I'm excited. And people start telling me, Brother Mike, you need to tone it down a little bit. And I would ask questions. Well, brother, you know, you're just immature right now. You don't understand. what they were doing, and I did not recognize it. Rather than speaking into me and helping me grow, they were dropping their droppings in me, tarnishing me. And now, 30 years later, hello?
Amen.
I'm still wrestling with some of the stuff that was deposited in my spirit. Because pigeon religion, man religion, distorted word teaching has a detrimental effect on you. It's almost cultic.
Yes, it does.
And the damage that it does.
Yes, right.
Because let me tell you something, when you get filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost and you begin to walk in the freedom and the dove returns to your home and he returns to your church, amen, there's a lot of stuff that you used to do you don't do no more. A lot of stuff that you used to allow to happen you don't allow to happen anymore. Why? Because along with the presence of the dove, amen, comes the fear of God. It comes the weightiness of God's kabod. Amen. And then it's not that you want to be mean. It's not that you want to be critical. Amen. It's just that you're got a more weighty matter on you. Rather than trying to please Brother Larry, amen, I've got to please God. Amen. Rather than trying to please the church, I've got to please God. Because in the end, church, we're going to stand before Almighty God.
Amen.
That's right. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
And so, be careful what you allow to land upon you.
That's right.
Pigeons are unafraid of humans. They like gossip. They like shroud themselves in drama. And the more spicy it is, the more they like it.
That's right.
I've been in church long enough, I know this happens. I didn't fall off the watermelon truck yesterday. But you can go to somebody and say, look, Brother so-and-so told me to tell you in confidence not to say this, but it's just you and I can trust you. You ever been there?
Oh, yeah.
Come on.
Oh, yeah.
And then you get that little bit of gossip, and then you go to somebody else that you trust and say, look, now, don't tell, brother said don't tell you, but I just want to share. I better go on. Pigeons are unafraid. Doves don't do that. This is something else I want you to understand. Pigeons can be trained. They can be domesticated.
Yes.
Did you know that?
Yes.
That's why during World War II, they would tie notes on pigeons and let them go, and they'd fly 200 miles. And they'd come back with a message. Because they were trained to do that. A dove only returns for survival. Listen, I'm going to close. You remember when old Noah was on the ark?
Yep. Yep.
And the first bird he sent out was a raven?
Nope.
Didn't come back. But the second one, a few days later, he sent out a dove. And the Bible said the dove came back and had an olive branch in his mouth. See, because he needed that safety, not only of the message that there's land, but he needed the safety of the ark. The ark represented Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. The Holy Spirit is going to dwell where Christ is welcomed. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I want you to know that the dove is returning to Victory Tabernacle. I want you to know that we're going to see things that we've never seen and experience things that we've never experienced. Amen. We're going to welcome the dove back. Amen. Hallelujah. With signs, wonders, and miracles. Amen. We're going to do things we've never done. See things that we've never seen, experience things that we haven't experienced. Why? Because it's the will of God.
Yes, right.
Amen.
And let me close with this. Y'all come on, Brother Robert. This is what I like about the dove. A pigeon has many mates. A pigeon's a church hopper. A pigeon will run from church to church. But a dove stays at home. Through thick or thin, through storms, through adversity, the dove remains. A song they sang, sometimes it takes a mountain. Sometimes a stormy sea. Sometimes a wilderness for God to get a hold of me. When you're hovered, when that dove is hovering over you, amen, when that dove, and listen, I want you to, I didn't want to get ahead of this, but in closing, when you go and look at John, the Holy Spirit abode upon him. He stays with us. I want you to understand, when you get the baptism of the Holy Spirit will stay with you. Amen. Well, Brother Bassmeyer, how come the things happen? Because we get the presence of the Lord in the anointing confused. The anointing would leave you. Amen. But the presence of God won't leave you. Amen. That's why it's important. Amen. As we pray and welcome the Holy Spirit. Amen. He's in us. He's tabernacled in us. Amen. And he wants to abode with us. Amen. But we need to allow the anointing to come back. We need to allow the workings of the Holy Spirit to come back and operate in our church. Amen. That he will be effective. We talked about it this morning. Amen. Amen. One of the things that's missing in the church today is the evidence. Amen. The evidence. 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 Amen. Let me tell you something. If I talk about a bottle of water or a cup of water, that's one thing. But if I've got the evidence, that's proof that I know what I'm talking about. Elijah. I've said this before and I'll say it again. Went against 450 false prophets of Baal. The dove went against pigeon religion. What did pigeon religion do? Does what we do every Sunday. They danced to their God. They worshiped. Oh, they hollered and hooped, and we hoop and we holler. Amen. We do our spiritual thing. Oh, come on, Lord. Come, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Come, Lord. We do all of our Baal stuff that they did because we're pigeons. And nothing happens. But then our flesh man gets satisfied. But what happens when the dove shows up? The dove will take an altar and build it. Lay logs upon it. The dove will say, bring me 12 barrels of water and pour water upon the altar. You see, because the dove doesn't have confidence in the flesh, it has confidence in the Father. It knows what the voice of the Father sounds like. It walks in boldness. It walks by faith and not by sight. And as Elijah, the prophet of God, who represented the dove of God, amen, called upon God. He didn't go into no hand sprints. He didn't dance and jig and hoop and holler like we do to try to get God's attention. Amen. He walked in the Spirit. Amen. He knew the voice of God. And he stood, Sister Selena, and he looked into the heavens. Amen. And he prayed and God answered and sent fire down. And it consumed the altar. It leapt up the water. It burnt the wet wood and brought the altar to ashes. There's evidence. And guess what the false prophets did? Guess what the pigeons did? They cried out, the God of Elijah, he's real. He's real. You know why the world don't fear God? You know why the world doesn't fear God? You know why it's almost preachers today are in pigeon religion of entertainment, having to get people to come to see a show on Sunday morning? It's because the dove's not allowed in their home. The dove is not allowed. Why? Because it takes prayer. Amen. Preachers are not calling people to pray anymore. Preachers are not calling people to fast anymore. Preachers are not telling people to read the book anymore. And tell them how to be motivated and feel good about themselves and not to offend anyone. And the dove leaves. But can I tell you what? As the dove returned on the ark, the dove's returning to the church.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. The dove's returning to the church. Amen. Stand with me this morning. Hallelujah. There's a lot more to this. The Lord leads next week to conclude it. But I want you to this morning, today's Pentecost Sunday. Today's Pentecost Sunday. It's the 50th day after the resurrection. And on Pentecost Sunday, they went into the upper room. And a dove flew in and filled 120 of them. And it so profoundly affected them that they went out on the streets sharing the message of the dove. And over 3,000 people got saved and filled with the Holy Ghost. And then the dove was able to flow in their lives so profoundly that a few days later, 5,000. And then the dove began to shake the world. Signs, wonders, and miracles were wrought by the hands of the apostles because the dove flowed in them unrestricted. The dove had the ability to flow without reason or compromise because they hungered so much for God. The dove was so strong that when Ananias and Sapphira lied about selling some land and giving all their money and they kept back, they may have sold it for $1,000 and said, look, we sold our land for $1,000 and gave it to the church. And really what all they gave was a couple hundred dollars. But see, if you don't know, it sounds like, man, they blessed. They sold their land and gave it to the church, but they lied. And the dove, the presence of the dove was so strong that they died right there. Ananias died first. A couple hours later, his wife came in. And she took part of it, and she paid the price with her husband. When the dove shows up, things begin to happen. I challenge you as we leave this morning to go this week and allow God, the Holy Ghost, to begin to transform you. Allow God, the Holy Ghost, to speak to you. Amen. That, Lord, and recognize we're all pigeons, church. Come on, let's be real. That God will transform us into the vessel that He wants us to be.
Amen.
That we will welcome Him in our home, in our church. Because if you allow Him in your home, you don't have to huff and puff when you get to church for a move of God. Amen. You come in with Him. If half of us would get a hold of God in our homes, in our cars, amen, and joyfully come to church on Sunday morning, let me tell you something, amen, we would have an electrifying move of God. There would be power like you've never seen before. But you know what's happening right now? Because the doves are so temperamental and sensitive, pigeons often run doves away. God have mercy on us. God have mercy on us. Father, I thank you for this day. If you need prayer, we want to pray for you. We never want to leave without the opportunity to seek the face of God. I know there's things to do and places to go, but let's just tarry a moment. And ask the Holy Spirit to come. Holy Spirit, come. Just let Him into your heart. Let Him fill your temple with His presence.
Grace through faith when you came.
Don't resist the flood of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Let him tabernacle in you. Let him move in you. Let him lead you and guide you. Don't quench the Holy Spirit. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. I didn't even cover that this morning, but I will next week as the Lord leads. What we do in our services that grieves and hinders the Holy Spirit a lot of times just by our thoughts.
You hung on a tree.
But I want you this morning to come. If you need prayer, we want to pray for you. You have to go. You're dismissed in Jesus' name, but I encourage you to tarry. I encourage you to let the Holy Spirit tabernacle in you this morning. Let your brethren come and pray with these, amen, that have come down today. Father God, I pray for these precious souls, whatever need it is that they need, God. And we're going to lay hands on them. We're going to pray for them. Father God, we're going to believe this morning that transformation is taking place in their life. Father God, that they're running the pigeons out of their lives, out of their minds, out of their heart, and welcoming you, Holy Spirit. Welcome you. Welcome you, the Lord of their life, to come and tabernacle inside of them for your glory.
Shall come and be free. But at the cross, you lay down your life so I could find mine. Lord, I've never known a love like this before. You hung on a tree. There you thought of
Father God, in the name of
all
Jesus, I know the work of the enemy, God, is to destroy family, to cause separation, misunderstanding. And God, oftentimes it's over little and untrivial things, but God, I ask you to come this morning, Holy Spirit.
That you would reach out.
Judy, Lord God, you see the desire of her heart is the restoration of her family.
Who am I?
Father God, I know what you can do for her. Don't I'm saying you're doing it in my children's lives. God, where the enemy came in and separated now, God, forgiveness. And Lord God, I ask you, Lord God, to find Judy the desire of her heart. To have a relationship with her daughter. Lord God, that by example, Lord God, that she will be the leader.
But at the cross,
she will come back into your presence.
You lay down your life.
So I could find mine. By your conversation, by your compassion, by your love and your devotion to God. They will see that light shine in you, and they will be attracted to that.
Hallelujah.
Lord, you lift him up. You said, I will draw people.
There you thought of me.
Lift Jesus up in your home. Press through the pain. Press through the questions. She might cut you out over the phone when your heart's devastated, but you still press through that. Say, God, I don't receive it. I don't receive it, God. I'm pressing through, Lord, because you hear me when I pray. God, you said you give me the desire of my heart, and the desire of my heart is to see my children saved. And God, I'm not going to believe the lie of the devil. I'm not going to believe this circumstance. I'm not going to believe this open road.
Have been covered.
You trust God.
By your
bring it to
save by grace through faith.
In the name of Jesus.
When you came, you made a way. Now whosoever will may come and be free. At the cross, you lay down your life.
God, that you're
so I could find mine.
Maybe hidden from her, but yet God.
Lord, I've never known a love like this before. Hung on a tree. There you thought of me.
married. Is who am I? To embrace God like you've never embraced Him before, not because of the circumstances that's come in.
Lord, who am I?
But this is a distraction. You can have the mind of God, the presence of God right now, just as strong as you've ever had before. So, Lord, but the enemy will come in and use a small affair to distract you from the purpose of God. He will create a stumbling block because of the emotion, because of what we see in the natural. But he's doing something in the spiritual. He's developing you. He's developing. He'll use a hoe. He'll use an axe. He'll use a chainsaw. He'll use whatever tool that he's got to use to get to you. Because there's something inside of you that is after you. That you can look at this right square in the face and say, me and my house, me and my house, we're going to worship the Lord. Me and my house is going to entertain the presence of the Holy Spirit. Because God has got a word on the Lord. He's got a powerful word to flow through these hands and to minister to women that have gone through what you've gone through. They need a leader. They need a vanguard. They need a woman of God that cries out in the wilderness. As real as it may be, he'll use the circumstances of eternity to get your mind off of your purpose. Because you can have ministry. You can still do what God's called you to do. For this situation in your life. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I know this woman hears from you. I know, God, there's a divine flow that's flowing through her. She can't even fathom. God, I ask you right now, in the name of Jesus, I speak peace and rest. I speak peace and rest. That's what you need. Is peace and rest. Hebrews chapter 4, enter into his rest. That nothing bothers you. That nothing bothers you. Just take you to bring it to you. Bring it on, the devil. Is this all you got? Because you'll have so much peace that it makes the devil mad. Because what he meant.